And then take up your cross and serve him. And of course, Jesus said if you serve him, you what you do is you serve your neighbor. And so you become a useful part of your family, a useful part of your church, a useful part of your community, of your nation, and you help win the world for him. You're ready to reach out for him. You become a part of the world of evangelization, and I just praise God for you. So what comes alive is you are, according to 1 Thessalonians 3:23, in the very God of peace sanctify you wholly, and I pray God your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. What that's talking about there is that we are made up of three parts. We have a spirit, we have a soul, and we have a body. And so when you accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, your spirit became alive to Christ, okay? And now you commune with him on that level. It's a very beautiful thing to know that we can do that. Chapter 8, verse 18, it says, "For I reckon that the suffering of the present time are not worthy of the to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." And so what we really, what he's saying is that all the sufferings that you do in this world are going to be worth it, okay? It's going to be, the next world is promised by God, and you're going to have much joy and fellowship with him forever and ever. In John 1:12 says, "But as many as received him, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God." And 2 Corinthians 6:17-18, it says, "Wherefore come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I'll receive you, and will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, said the Lord Almighty." In Galatians 4, verses 4 through 6, says this, "When the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And because ye are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father." And so we have the very spirit of Christ in us. You know, we have God living in us every single day. And he says, this is what I kind of love, "For thou art a holy people unto God, unto the Lord thy God. And the Lord hath chosen you to be a peculiar people unto himself." Deuteronomy 14:2. Now we are a peculiar people, aren't we? You know, I'm kind of peculiar anyway. But now once you become a Christian, you're different than everyone else. When you go out into that community where you might live, not everybody has the same spirit living in them that you have. And you are different. You're called out. You're changed. You're holy. When God looks down upon you, he sees someone who is holy. You're holy. Think about that, to be holy. Now, you don't feel holy, do you? But that's how God sees you. Why does he see you that way? Because the Spirit of God lives within you. Because your sins have been washed away. When Jesus Christ died on the cross, he washed away our sins, and you became peculiar in the world. Most of the world, it's a narrow road, most of the world doesn't have the joy that we have to know the Lord. America is a wonderful place because the word is preached all across America. You can hardly go a block without somebody preaching the gospel, you know. People even come and knock on your door and want to tell you the gospel of Jesus Christ. And if you visit church, they cheer you almost. They're so happy to see you. So you wonder, why are they so happy to see me? Well, because God loves you. He wants you to have that joy. How can we be sure we're saved? Well, in verse 16, he just told you that. The Holy Spirit communicates then with our spirit, and the Spirit bears witness with our spirit. Expectation, verse 19. "But the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the Son of God." Verse 19. Now, the creatures, I mentioned this morning that that we've been in a war since the beginning of time. It's a war between good and evil. It started in heaven with the angels when Lucifer rebelled against God. And he came down to man and he gave his rebellion to us, and we had the fall of man with Adam and Eve. And we came out of the garden, and the world was still a beautiful place. At that time, the world was probably all one continent. Now science tells us, they go back and they say it was 20 or 30 million years ago, but there was a place called Pangaea in the Greek. And it was just one continent. Now if you look at the continents, you can kind of see how they all fit together, you know? Well, man didn't live up to God's expectations. Even after Adam and Eve left and went out into left the garden and went out into the world and found this great big huge world, a huge continent, just lush and gorgeous, and they didn't live up to it. They became rich and they forgot all about God. And there was a flood. Okay. And Pangaea was, of course, never the same. It's the continents are still drifting apart. And so when Adam fell, all creation fell. This world was created for us, okay? And so when that flood happened, the whole of this earth was changed. But when the fall happened, I think the whole universe was changed. It's just not the same as it was. And we're waiting for the Redeemer, the one who's going to put it all back together for us. And that was Jesus Christ. And he's going to come a second time. The first time he came to save us from our sins, to free us from the slavery that we were in, the slavery of sin and death. And that's what happened with Adam's fall. Sin and death came into the world. And when Jesus Christ came, we now have a hope. Now, when you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you received salvation. It's a now thing. It's done right now. But you're not seeing God face to face. So still, we call it a hope. And we have got to walk in the faith, the hope, that what His Word tells us and what our Spirit tells us when we pray and face to face to us there, and our spirit tells us that we have eternal life. We live in that hope every single day, and we walk in that hope every single day. And so what we actually have is we live in our eternal life's here, but we're only tasting it. See, after we die and we're glorified and our sin nature is gone away and God gives us a new body, we're not going to just taste it anymore. We're going to have the real thing, the full thing. We're going to have the full fellowship, face to face with God, forever and ever and ever. It's going to be a really wonderful, wonderful, wonderful time in the history of mankind. So right now we're going through spiritual warfare. In this life, the believers suffer and struggles. The word suffering means that all the forms of suffering which the believer experiences through this life, it means the suffering that comes from persecution. It's happening here in America. It's happening in the Middle East right now. Can you imagine what it's like to be Afghanistan and to be a believer? And yet our missionaries have probably won hundreds, maybe thousands of people in Afghanistan to Christ. And those people are in mortal fear for their life right now. And a terrible persecution. But it's all going to be worth it in the end. But they have to keep that hope alive in their hearts through faith. Very simply, suffering means the struggles waged by our spirits to overcome all that we experience or that is experienced in this life. All that is involved in the flesh and the world. It's sin and corruption, disease and pain, abuse and persecution, unregulated urges and desires, weakness and shortcomings, aging and loss, deterioration and decay. We all go through these things, and yet we have to keep that hope alive, that true knowledge, that sure knowledge that God has promised us will come true. See, Jesus did all the work on the cross, and now grace is given. He paid the price for us. In verse 19 it says, for the earnest expectation of the creature, that's the universe, but more specifically, it's us, you and me. The earnest is, that word is talking about, you know when you go into the store and you buy something on layaway, you know? You bought it, it belongs to you, but now you gotta kinda, you gotta work it out, and then you come back later on and you get it, right? When you accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, it's yours, okay? And now we're working out our salvation. It's really all ours right now. And it's a sure thing we're going to have it. And so it's an earnest expectation. We're going to see it. One day we're going to be face to face to God. And he's going to say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Come on in. And all he's going to see, really, God, the Father's going to see is the righteousness of Christ wrapped around us. Because we are in Christ. We're in Christ. Right? We're God's people. We're his children. We're in Christ. We're wrapped in his gown, you know. So, it's like putting goods on layaway. You know, Christ is coming back for you. He is coming back for us. You know, it's like the Jewish wedding. The price was paid. You know, you go. That's the ancient Jewish wedding. The bride price would be paid. The agreement was made, and so they're engaged. You know, but really they're married. So Joseph and Mary were really. It, for all practical purposes, they were married, but they had not consummated the marriage. Why? Well, then the groom goes away, he prepares a house for the bride, and then, without warning, at any time, could be a year later, he comes back for his bride. You know, his best man blows the trumpet, you know, and out comes all the bridesmaids, you know, and he receives his wife, and they have a 7-day feast, and the marriage is consummated. Well, Jesus Christ is the groom, and we are the bride. And the bride price was paid on the cross, paid in full. And now we're just waiting for the groom, Jesus Christ, to come back to receive his bride. That's the rapture when he comes back for us, you know. He comes back and receives us to himself. And then there's that marriage supper of the Lamb. I think that's going on right now. Revelations, we see it. It's 19:7. We see that going on even right now. All creatures, all creations shared in the fall of man. This earth is not what it's going to be. You know, one day Jesus Christ is going to come back. He's going to live and reign for 1,000 years right here. And we're going to live and reign with him. And you can see that in Revelation chapter 5, but I'm out of time. I had that in my mind to go into that, but we'll live and reign with him. And then at the end of that time, there's going to be Satan is going to be loosed, and then of course he's going to be defeated again, and then the earth will be renewed. It will be either just burned up in a brand new earth, or it will be recycled. This earth will be recycled. And so we have that to look forward to. We keep our minds and our hearts in that. Salvation will restore earth, and nature itself will be changed. So much God loves us. Death and sickness will end. The earth will be a kinder place. I don't know how it's going to happen, whether it's a new earth or a recycled earth, but it's going to be a kinder place. And the whole universe, I'm sorry about you Star Wars buffs and everything, but it's all going to be restored. There aren't going to be any, all those terrible monsters that fly around there and in those Star Wars and science fiction. Jesus Christ is not science fiction. He's king of the whole universe. He created everything that is. He owns it. The universe itself will be restored, because the creature itself also shall be delivered from bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. All creation will be restored. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. Verse 22. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves, groan with ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. We're waiting for that day when Christ returns, you know, and he and all of the travail of this earth goes away, you know, and we receive a new body. And a new life in Christ forever and ever to be with Him. We don't have to fear aging, sickness, or death. Those are just temporary things. They're going to go away. And we're going to live in eternity with Him. What joy, what happiness, as we are restored to Christ. What we only taste now in prayer and service to God, we're just tasting it, we'll have it in all its glory. We'll have glorified bodies, for we are saved by hope. But hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doeth he hope for? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. So wait, be patient. It's going to happen. You say, oh, it's never going to happen. It's going to happen. We're getting closer to it every single day. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is in the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. Even now Jesus Christ is at the right hand of the Father, interceding for us, watching out for us. That's why all things work together for good, that them that love God. We have a Savior who loves us and is now, right now, interceding for us in heaven. Make sure you pray. He wants us to pray and tell us our needs and our wishes and our hopes, our desires. And tell Him at the same time how much you love Him and worship Him too, will you? But He's there for us. Let's pray. Father in heaven, oh, what hope we have. We all can only taste, even with all the joy we Christians have in Christ, with all the peace that we have in Christ, with all the blessings that you pour on us every day, we know that this is just a taste of the eternity that we have ahead for us. We are so grateful, and we are so glad that we are the children of God, that we are in Christ, that we have one body of believers. We're part of that. We thank you for this. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.